Good morning to everyone here in person. Good morning to all of the Zoomers. It is a little bit after 5:30. We'll keep working on starting on time, but it really is a wonderful thing to be gathered together as God's people, to worship, to hear his word being proclaimed. It's good to have the Rousseaus. I've gotten to know Dave and Sue a little bit over the work we do out in Somerset, the Hope Training Course. It's really good to have you visit us. And as I scan around, I don't see new people. I do see Erin, who's back. She was away for a while. It's good to have you back, Erin. And sitting next to Michelle, Angela. Nice to have you join us, Angela. I think that's as many as all the new faces. I'm going to pray. We're going to stand and worship God as we reflect on his goodness, the work that he does in people's lives, and hopefully the work he is doing in our lives, even in this very moment. So I'm going to pray. We're going to stand. You Zoomers at home, make sure you've got ample space to really express your praise and thanks to God. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, this Sunday. We thank you for the joy that you give to your people. We thank you that we can be gathered to worship. This morning, we pray that you would receive our prayers as a token of thankfulness and gratitude for the work you do in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us stand.
bona ke a bona oh everybody ke a bona ke a bona
rescue the soul.
Continue to just reflect, maybe in the quietness of your own heart, reflect back those words to God. He is the one we need. Without God, there is no life. As Jesus has been teaching us in the final chats, without me, you can do nothing. And so maybe call out in the quietness of your own heart to this God who gives life, who gives grace, who gives healing, who gives hope. This is the God we've come to worship this morning. So why don't you just pray for your own hearts, and I will then pray for us as a community. Heavenly Father, we come before you in acknowledgement that you are God who is good, that you are indeed a good, good Father. It is your character. It is demonstrated by the works that you do, that you call us out of sin and you make us your own, that you give us Jesus, that you give us the Holy Spirit who's God with us and God in us. That by the Spirit we can cry out, Abba, Father. This morning, as a gathered community, we want to acknowledge that before you, we fail to live in light of your words. That before you, we don't say the right things. We don't do the right things. That sin always is competing for your glory. This morning, we want to come before you as a community. And we want to say, Bawo sixolele, Father, forgive us. We know that it is something that pleases you when your people, individuals, and as a community, acknowledge their sin and confess it. We know the promise that comes from your word that you not only forgive us our sins, but you cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And so this morning as a community, we pray, Father, forgive us. Forgive us for times we've not been kind. Forgive us for times we've not used the opportunity to speak about you. Forgive us when we've been grumpy, when we've been angry, when we've been impatient. And these are our regular daily experiences. But we know that here as a community gathered, when we confess any and all of those things, that you will forgive us. And this gives us great joy, merciful Father, that you have loved us and you have demonstrated your love to us in sending the Lord Jesus Christ, who dies on the cross to take away the sins of the world. What a privilege to call you our God, our Father. Continue to be with us this morning as we worship together, as we in a little while hear your word being preached to us. Father, open our hearts and help us to truly understand that you are at work in our midst and to truly celebrate that. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Once again, it really is a great privilege to be gathered together. I don't know how often you as an individual think and reflect on the goodness of community, on the goodness of being gathered, on the opportunity of really being able to say to one another, God is at work here. God lives here in this space. I really look forward to Sundays. I look forward to Sundays because they remind me of that. They remind me that God is at work. He's not finished. The work is started. And the hope that comes with knowing that is that the work he has started, he will bring to completion. So for you Zoomers at home, I hope you've had that opportunity to reflect and think and thank God for the work that is done for us here as we continue to do so. I'm just gonna bring some highlights to our church family news. I did send the news letter that I send weekly. So I'm hoping that you will read that because it has all of the news that you may need to know. So I'm just going to highlight a few for us now as we continue our time together. The first thing is that we will be having our AGM. That's the annual meeting where we reflect and think about the work that God has done in the year past. And we think and talk and plan and vote on decisions going forward in the life of the church. Now, usually, as I said in the newsletter, that happens not so long after Easter because of the type of year we've had. We have had to push that forward until the 13th of June. So 13th of June will be our AGM meeting where we will reflect and think together and pray together. And so what I'm going to be doing is I'm going to be sending a few requests to some of you who've got ministry opportunities in areas of service like the women's ministry, like schools, like GCs, just to hear the news amongst our community of what God is doing. And I would like that sent back to me by the 8th of June so that I can try and send it to everybody for opportunities of praying and thinking through what our day will be. It's meant to be a day of celebration and thanksgiving. And so after the service, it will be good on that Sunday, the 13th, to have eats. As I wrote, just bring foods that are easy to eat in such a time. And then we can really celebrate together. We've got a nice space at the back there. We've done it before, so we can have a mini picnic, as it were, on that day. So remember that, put it in your diaries, Sunday the 13th of June. Oh, sorry, I thought someone was correcting me on that. The second thing to say is that May is very slow in having anybody celebrate anything. We're already more than halfway through the month, but only two names to speak of in a community who will be celebrating on the 18th. Simon, who's not here today, will be celebrating his birthday. And then on the 19th, Dave LaRue, sitting right there, will be celebrating his birthday. So put that in your calendars. Send him a WhatsApp. Give him a call. Buy him a chocolate. Show him some love on the day of his birthday. We want to celebrate one another. We want to celebrate the things that God is doing in our lives. So that may be an opportunity for some of us who perhaps don't know Dave that well to give him a call and say, hey, take you out for a drink. We had a huge bowl of chips the other day, and it was very, very hard to finish a bowl of chips. So maybe next time we can have three people instead of two. So that's Simon and Dave. What else to bring to highlight? The membership classes, because if you want for your voice to be heard in the decisions that the church has to make, and there are big decisions that we are needing to make as we look forward, you need to be, according to this constitution of this local church, a member. So I will be running membership classes for those who want to do that. I was going to start this Sunday afternoon, but I've got a pressing matter, so I will start next Sunday. And we will have at least 2 weeks of just looking at a few topics and areas of concern of what it means to be a church member, so that come the 13th of June, you will be able to actually cast your vote on the decisions that are made. I think in terms of highlighting some news, those are the two news that are really, really important. The last one perhaps to say is that next week, Sunday, we will be having a guest preacher. The George Whitfield Bible College runs this thing called GWC Year or Day or Sunday, where they send out preachers from the college to various churches here in Cape Town. And we've got a preacher coming to speak to us, bring God's word, explain a little bit about what the college is all about, what it's doing, and how we as a community can get involved. So that's happening next Sunday here at the Student Y. I'm going to pray for the ministry that takes place to the children, the Sunday school. We thank God for the teachers that week in, week out, teach our children. Well, not my children, I don't have a child, but the children here at the Message. We thank God for that. So I want to pray and I give thanks to God for the work that they do as they head out to have their lessons. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you that you are God who is good, who is kind, that you are God who invites children to come and know and learn and grow in knowing who Jesus is. We thank you for the teachers who labor and who prepare so that they can teach these children the truth about Jesus. We pray this morning as the lessons take place that you would communicate your truth into their lives, and that by your grace, they may come to know you. We thank you. And as we continue to hear from your word, we pray that you bless us too. In Jesus' name, amen. So as the children perhaps go for the lesson, you can just turn to the neighbor, someone across from you, and just greet one another. And then those conversations can be continued after. So you can do that. Sorry about that. Okay. So the conversations that have begun, hopefully they'll be continued after coffee. I saw the LeRoux getting to know Mr. Levy here. I said, I promised you to show you the surname that's like yours. There, at the back there, is another Banda. You're all Banda. Eh? You all know it. Okay, so now that's the guy. It's an inside thing. I promised him to show him another Banda. But there we go. I'm going to read God's word for us now. And we're continuing in the series of John's Gospel, Jesus' final chats. And Gerard is going to come preach from chapter 15, verse 18 to 16, verse 4. So if you have your Bibles in any form, you can get there and I will read for us. And then Gerard will come to preach. John 15 from verse 18. If the world hates you, know that it has hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love you as its own. But because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. Remember the word that I said to you, a servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they kept my word, they will also keep yours. But all these things they will do to you on account of my name, because they do not know him who sent me. If I had not come and spoken to them, they would not have been guilty of sin. But now they have no excuse for their sin. Whoever hates me hates my Father also. If I had not done among them the works that no one else did, they would not be guilty of sin. But now they have seen and hated both me and my Father. But the word that is written in their law must be fulfilled. They hated me without a cause. But when the Helper comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth, who proceeds from the Father, he will bear witness about me. And you also will bear witness, because you have been with me from the beginning. I have said all these things to you to keep you from falling away. They will put you out of the synagogues. Indeed, the hour is coming when whoever kills you will think is offering service to God. And they will do these things because they have not known the Father nor me. But I have said these things to you that when their hour comes, you may remember that I told them to you. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Amen. Amen. Good morning. How are we doing? Good, good, good. Let me put this down. Well, a warm welcome to each of you. It's nice to have some visitors. Hello, David, too. Welcome. It's nice to have Aaron back. Welcome all the way from France. And I forgot your name, but a warm welcome. Glad you can be here. To the Zoomers at home, a warm welcome to you. If there are any visitors that have joined and logged on, a warm welcome to you. My name is Gerard. I'm one of the pastors here at the Message Church. If you have joined us for the first time, as San said, we're in the Gospel of John. We're doing a series called Jesus' Final Chats, or the Farewell Discourse with Jesus. It's his farewell speech. He's about to go to the cross, and so he's with his disciples, and he's talking to them. And we are, as Sans has read in John 15. Let me pray. Let me ask God to help us, and then we'll get going. Why don't you pray with me? Ask God to help us in his Holy Spirit to show us the truth. Father, thank you that we, as Sans has said, we can gather. Thank you that we can come together as your people and pledge our allegiance and reaffirm your goodness and faithfulness to us. Thank you for your word. Thank you for all of your word, even the difficult passages of your word. May they make us faithful people. Amen. So we had a marriage enrichment weekend a couple of weeks ago. We've got another one coming up. Do sign up. But we're using some videos from a guy called Paul Tripp. He's an American pastor, and he's written this book, and the title of the book is called What Did You Expect? It's a great title. And Tripp's whole aim is to show that the biggest problem in your marriage as you struggle is not your spouse, it's not your children, it's not your in-laws, it's not your circumstances, but it's actually yourself. You are your marriage's biggest problem. You are your marriage's biggest problem because you have wrong expectations. What did you expect? You have the wrong perspective of what marriage is and what it's supposed to be about. And so Paul wants to show us what we should expect from marriage and to understand ourselves in light of God, in light of his word, and in light of each other. It's a great book. And what I've enjoyed about the book so far is that he's trying to give us this perspective. He's trying to give us this perspective of what we should expect from marriage. And he knows that there are a host of perspectives or ideas that we come to marriage with, what we think it will be and what we think about intimacy. And so he wants to show us that having the right perspective will make our marriage flourish. Now, I thought about that title and I thought, well, that's the same with our walk with God, is it not? As we walk with God day to day, we need to have the right perspective, the right understanding of what it means to follow Jesus and be a Christian, particularly in between this time, between Jesus' first coming and the second coming. I think the wrong perspective of Jesus and what it means to follow him, I think will bring problems, will bring discouragement, and will bring disillusionment. And I think a lot of people's problems with Christianity is because maybe they haven't thought hard enough about what their faith is about. Who is the Savior that we follow? Often we want to preach about grace and Jesus as loving and kind and accepting. And he is all of those things. As Jesus as our Savior, as our Redeemer, and he is that. That's only one half of who Jesus is, what it means to follow him. I think the modern view of Christianity or following Jesus can have a cheap view of grace, a poor view of what it means to be a Christian. There's a Christian author, his name is Dietrich Bonhoeffer. He wrote about this idea of cheap grace, or this having a deficient view of discipleship. In his book, he writes, "Cheap grace is the preaching of forgiveness without requiring repentance, baptism without church discipline, communion without confession, absolution without personal confession. Cheap grace is grace without discipleship, grace without the cross, and grace without Jesus living and incarnate." And then he contrasts that with costly grace. He says, "Costly grace is the treasure hidden in the field. For the sake of it, a man will go and sell all that he has. It is the pearl of great price to buy, to which the merchant will sell all his goods. It is the kingly rule of Christ, for whose sake a man will pluck out the eye which causes him to stumble. It is the call of Jesus Christ at which the disciple leaves his nets and follows him." One offers that pains to show us that we mustn't have a cheap view of grace, triumphs without trials, witness without weariness. In short, Bonhoeffer is saying, sometimes the version of Christianity we want is this crown, and we forget about the cross. The crown without the cross. And he says this will lead to a shallow and a deficient view of discipleship. And often we may get disillusioned with what it means to actually follow Jesus. And so we need the right perspective. And in many ways, this section in John's Gospel, John 13 to 17, as Jesus focuses on his disciples, this new covenant community, is actually trying to shape them. A big part of this part is him saying, "I'm leaving." And they're sad, they're troubled. We looked at this a couple of weeks ago. He is leaving and he's trying to give them the right perspective. How are you going to live in light of my departure? And that's what he's doing. And that's why it's a great section of John's Gospel. He's preparing them to carry on his mission in light of his departure. And last week we looked, an integral part to that is remaining in the vine. John 15, that key section. "I am the vine, my Father is the vine dresser." We need to abide in Jesus to produce fruit. And now we come to this difficult passage. It's a hard passage. Jesus wants to give us perspective of what it looks like to follow him. And he tells us this. I don't know if you noticed, have a look. If you have your Bible open, glance down to 16 verse 1. I think what he's trying to do here is reorientate us. He's saying, I've said these things to you to keep you from falling away. And look at verse 4. I've said these things to you that when your hour comes, you may remember that I told them to you. So he's preparing them. He doesn't want them to be surprised. I think he's trying to give them the right perspective. I don't want you to fall away. Forewarned will be forearmed to deal with life, to deal with what it means to follow him. And if you notice in that verse, the danger of a poor perspective, the danger of faulty discipleship or cheap grace, so to speak, is not that we will die, is that we might fall away. We might move away from Jesus, we might apostatize because we don't understand what it meant to follow Jesus. Obviously, Jesus is firstly talking to his disciples, yeah? They are the ones that will continue his mission. We are the fruit of that discipleship, but these verses apply to us too. He wants to equip them with the right perspective. And I think the overarching principle, the first thing that he says that I want to draw attention to is there in verse 20. So John 15, verse 20, he says, remember the word that I said to you. Remember, giving them perspective. A servant is not greater than his master. Us, as the servants of the disciples of Jesus, we cannot be greater than Jesus. And Jesus' point is simple enough. That must shape our perspective. That must shape our worldview of Jesus and our place in his world. No servant is greater than his master. What the master went through, the servants will go through. What the master encounters, the servants will encounter. I think costly discipleship will recognize that. Look what Jesus says about following him. Not easy things. It will bring hatred, it will bring persecution, it will bring exclusion, it might bring death. 18 and 19, Jesus says, if the world hates you, know that it has hated me before it hated you. If you are of the world would love you as its own, but because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. And then, no servant is greater than his master. They persecuted me, they'll persecute you. We skip down to 16, we read that earlier. They'll put you out of the synagogues. A time is coming when someone will kill you and think that they're offering a service to God. It might bring you to death. Jesus is saying to us this morning, he wants to give us the perspective that no servant will be greater than the master. And the cross we will need to pick up may entail hatred, persecution, or exclusion, or even death. As I was preparing this, I was thankful that we do expository preaching, that we decide to pick a book of the Bible and do a section of the Bible and look at it. Because I think if I was having to pick a text for us this morning, I don't think I would have picked this chapter. I don't think this is what I want to share this morning with all of you. Here's your pep talk for the week. No, we need to preach all of God's word, and this is God's word to us, to you this morning. That if you want to be a follower of Jesus, you will need to pick up your cross, and that might mean hatred and persecution and exclusion and even death. I pray we may be worthy of that. In the second half of the sermon, I really just want to look at what are the reasons. What are the reasons that Jesus says the world may hate you, the world may persecute you, the world may exclude you? I think we need to get that right as we build our perspective, as we think of our place in God's world. And I think there are just two I want to draw out this morning. The first one is, you'll be hated because you are not of the world. That's the first one. The second one is, because the world does not know God, and Jesus Christ whom he sent. And I think that's the two reasons Jesus gives us as to why we may be hated, persecuted, excluded, and potentially killed. So the first reason, you're not of the world. Here I'm looking at John 15, 18, and 19. If the world, let me read it again. If the world hates you, know that it hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love you as its own. But because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world. Therefore, the world hates you. Jesus says, if you are my follower, you have been drawn out of the world. It doesn't love you as its own. And we saw this. Jesus said that in our previous chapter, in our previous passage last week. I didn't touch on it too much, but 15, 16, he says, you did not choose me. I chose you and appointed you that you should go bear fruit and that that fruit should abide. Jesus has chosen them. He's appointed them as his followers. He's brought them under his allegiance, under his lordship, in a sense, under his flag. They are his people. We are his people. As he did that to the disciples, he has done that to us. And so we've been chosen out of the world. We live under a different allegiance, a different perspective. Notice Jesus says, if you were of the world would love you as its own. I think here's the contrast. Jesus is saying, because you are under another allegiance, another flag, another Lord, it doesn't love you. You are aliens. You are strangers in this place. Because the world will love its own. It will embrace them. It will accept them because we conform, or because it wants us to conform to its allegiances, to its perspectives. And so you'll be hated because you don't do that as you are brought into Jesus's kingdom, to the kingdom of God under his lordship. As you live there, they won't love you. And they love you because you don't conform. And we don't conform to its principles. I'm sure you can think of some of these things in your workplace or on the university campus. We'll be hated if we don't conform to the world's understanding of gender, what it means to be a man or a woman, of our sexuality. I think we will be hated when we don't conform to this therapeutic culture that we live in. The culture says, okay, guys, look within yourself. Your deep longings, your deep desires, and those are the things you must follow. Those are the things that must stir you. Those are the things that you must pursue. Those are the things that must lead you. But when you come under the Lordship of Jesus and you hold to his a biblical definition of those things, it's truth outside of yourself, not your deepest longings, not your deepest desires, but a biblical definition of sex and of marriage and of identity and of gender. You will be excluded when you hold to those things. You will be removed and you will be hated. You don't conform to the world, and that's why the world won't love you. The world might hate you when you don't conform to its moral or ethical practices in your companies or with your bosses, when you don't value profits over people. You will be persecuted. I know that there are folks here that have been persecuted. When you don't use your gifts or your talents to advance your own personal gain, to seek to follow the kingdom of God first, friends and family may ridicule you and say, you could be better. Why is this Jesus thing so serious? And I know that there are people that have counted the cost this morning, that have been hated for Jesus' name. And so I want to say, keep going, brother and sister. Hold fast. Don't be discouraged and don't be surprised. Your perspective needs to be grounded in what Jesus says. If they hated me, they will hate you. No servant is greater than his master. The Apostle Peter says to you this morning, as he wrote to the church that was under persecution, for Nero, as they were dipped in tar and lifted up to be tortured, as they were killed for being Christians, he says, beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery trial when it comes upon you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice insofar as you share Christ's sufferings, that you may also rejoice and be glad when his glory is revealed. There's the crown. If you were insulted for the name of Jesus, you are blessed because the spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. Peter, who heard these words first, needed to learn that perspective as well, and writes to the church who is suffering. We must share in the cross. We want to share in the glory. We must pick it up. The world will hate us because we are not loved by it. We're not conformed to it. But the second reason the world will hate you is because they don't know God. Here I'm drawing on verses 20 and 21. If you have your Bibles, I'll read them again. Jesus says, remember the word I said to you, the servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will persecute you. If they kept my word, they will keep yours also. But all these things they will do to you on account of my name, because they do not know him who sent me. Again, Jesus says, remember this word. Remember it when it comes. Don't forget this lesson. This will happen on account of my name. And that means just for Jesus' sake, you'll be persecuted. And then he says again, he highlights this point again in 16, the last bit. He says, all these things, because they have not known the Father or me. Because the world does not know God the Father and God the Son, they will persecute us and hate us. Now, I think we need to be a little bit careful of what this verse means. I don't think it's because the world doesn't know about Jesus. You see, we can know about God in an abstract way, in a way that I know about President Cyril Ramaphosa. I know about him. I don't really know him intimately. I know that he's the president. And I think that's what he means here, that they won't know God in a salvific sense, in a salvation way, in a saving way. And I think this is clarified in the next couple of verses. So Jesus is not saying it's because they don't know me at all. They're ignorant. They've never heard of Jesus. It's because they don't know him in this way. And look what he says next. He says, if I had not come and spoken to them, they would not be guilty of sin. But now they have no excuse for their sin. Whoever hates me hates my Father also. If I had not done among them the works that no one else did, they would not be guilty of sin. But now they have seen and hated both me and my Father. Now the original context, Jesus is talking to his disciples and he's talking about the Jews initially. Remember, we started this sermon by saying there's a turning point in John's gospel. In verse 12, in chapter 12, we have these harrowing words. Though Jesus had done so many signs before them, they still did not believe in him. And so I'm convinced that they will hate, they will persecute because they don't know God in a salvation, in an intimate way. Let me draw some threads together. When we started the series, I got up here and I said one of my favorite chapters in all the Bible was John 17. And hopefully we're going to get there. And one of my favorite verses in all the Bible is John 17, 3. And so Jesus is praying, his high priestly prayer, and he says these words. This is eternal life, John 17, 3. That they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. And I pointed out in that time, salvation is not about this ticket that we hand out. You know, this ticket you receive, this one-way ticket to heaven. You know, I want to escape judgment in hell, so I'm going to, you know, get my ticket to leave. Here, John and Jesus is actually saying, it's so much bigger. It's so much deeper. It's being drawn into this loving and deeply knowing relationship between the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. That's what salvation is. So in a sense, we're eternal beings because that's what eternal life is. So we come to truly know the Father as he is, as we come to know the Son and the Holy Spirit. And I think the world will hate us because it doesn't know them in that way. It might know about them. And I want to make the case and draw the argument that they will hate because I think knowing God, I think we've seen this in the previous chapter, the previous sermon, knowing God has a responsibility to it. There's a commitment to knowing the Father and the Son, to being a Christian. It's not just I've received my ticket, I'm on my way to heaven. And I think that's the difference between cheap grace and costly grace. Cheap grace will say you can have your relationship with Jesus. You don't have to have any commitment or responsibility. You can have your one-way ticket to heaven at no cost. Costly grace says you know and you have a relationship with Jesus, and that was at no cost. That was at God's cost. But there is a commitment and a responsibility to that knowledge, to that knowing God. Last week I asked the question, the leading question for the sermon was, how can we know if we're Christians? That was a question that was asked after Sans preached. I started off the sermon by quoting John 15, 8. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit and so prove to be my disciples. And that's building on his teaching that he said already. You'll prove to be my disciples by your love for one another. And that's the new command he gives. And then we said the bearing of fruit is obeying Jesus' commands. If you look after 8, 10, and 11, if you keep my commands, you will abide in my love, just as the Father kept, just as I've kept the Father's commands and abide in his love. And he goes on to say, this is the command. that you love one another. So to know God in an intimate sense, to know God in a salvific sense, there comes a responsibility with that. We can't just be left to our own ways. We need to bear fruit. We need to obey God's commands. And I think this radical obedience to Jesus, that's what we said, you will obey my commands, I think is why the world will hate us, because they don't know. They're not responsible to that knowledge. And as we know, there is a responsibility in which we are to live. This is my command, that you love one another. As we love each other, as we speak the truth to each other, I think we will be persecuted. The world will not understand that we draw our allegiances, our ideals, our perspectives of the world, not from them, not from that world, but from God's kingdom. Because they don't know that, I think there will be persecution. Knowledge brings responsibility. But here's the catch. I think the world knowing we are Jesus' disciples, as I've already pointed out, can have two effects. And I think this is why this section hangs together. We abide in Jesus, bear fruit, obey his commands, love one another. And then the next section is, as you do that, there'll be hatred. See, there's a positive effect and a negative effect. As the world looks and says, yes, you are Jesus' disciples, positively, they may be drawn to that. And that is a powerful witness, a deep love for each other, communal love. And they may say, I want what you want. I want to lay down my life. I want to follow Jesus because we have something that the world doesn't give. We may have the negative effect. And I think we need to be ready for that. And I think here Jesus shares the negative effect. That as they know you are Jesus' disciples, as they see your love, they may be put off by that. They may be disgusted and dismayed that you don't follow after them, that you don't do what they do. And so the real application is, will we be orientated? Will we have the perspective that Jesus wants us to have? That to follow him is to pick up his cross, and that may entail hatred and persecution, even death. And then the next application, I want to just draw on the last two verses. I mean, verses 26 and 28. Let me read them. When the Helper comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth, who proceeds from the Father, he will bear witness about me. You will also bear witness because you have been with me from the beginning. When I first read that, I thought to myself, what does that have to do with what Jesus is talking about? Because if you notice on either side of this passage, it's about suffering and persecution, about exclusion and about death. And in this part, he's got this little section about the Holy Spirit. And I was like, what's the point? And I think it adds to what I've been saying about expecting two responses. Jesus continues and he says, the Holy Spirit, the Helper. I remember Sans preached on 2 weeks ago, and he said, I'm not leaving you as orphans. Although I am departing, I'm going to send another helper. And that word can be translated as advocate, but it's basically talking about the Holy Spirit. As Jesus has been the helper, the advocate with them, he is sending another one. And here we get the role of the Holy Spirit, and we'll explore this a little bit more in the weeks to come. The Holy Spirit will come, who proceeds from the Father, and he will bear witness about me. And you also, as the disciples, will bear witness about me. And so here Jesus is saying, shape your perspective as you bear witness, as the Holy Spirit empowers us. The world will know you are my disciples. Positively, they may want to cling to the rock that is Jesus. But negatively, they may persecute us, and they may actually trip over Jesus and persecute us. And I think that's what we should expect as we follow Jesus, as the Spirit empowers us to live faithful lives. And so I'm hoping this morning that we can, as followers of Jesus, as ones who say we pledge allegiance to him and follow him, that we would have our perspective grounded in that, that we would know that there is a cost to following Jesus and being witness about him. Let me pray and ask God to help us. Father, thank you for these words that the Helper, the Holy Spirit, who proceeds from you, will bear witness. He will bear witness about you. And thank you that in a way we are the fruit of him bearing witness to the disciples. And that this promise is for us to also bear witness about you. And Lord, may we shape our perspective. May we think of our Christian faith and our Christian walk in light of what you say. That no servant is greater than his master. And that if they have hated and persecuted you, that they will hate and persecute us because they don't know you. And so, Lord, I pray that we would continue to bear fruit, to love one another, hold each other to the gospel truths. I pray that you do this in this community this morning and that your Son may be glorified. Amen. I think we have some time for some questions. I don't know if there are any additions or questions. You just check on Zoom if there's anybody. I don't know if the Zoomers want to ask, they can also ask something. You can ask me afterwards too if you want. All right. No questions? Okay. Anyone from Zoom, Sam? Right. Over to you. Maybe people are just afraid. I know in our GC we looked at a study and there are loads of questions. So don't be afraid when the questions come. No, you're good. Answers are sorted. All right. That's good. We're going to stand and worship one last time as we just reflect on what Jared has said. The Victor's Crown is a song that just reminds us of all that Jesus has been, is doing. And so we can end with that, and then there'll be more coffee and maybe some more eats afterwards. I don't know if there were leftovers from the beginning. I can see by looking around, I saw that people are getting chillos. So we're going to try and provide some heaters. We've got heaters stored up somewhere. We're going to try and bring those up here because the winter's about to eat people alive. So next week, hopefully, it will be a warmer situation. Let's stand and worship.
engage in gathering together. I hope and I pray that those words that we had today, as Gerard preached to us, will be words that we seek to live by and understand who we are and whose we are. There's coffee and more eats afterwards. The conversations you started during that break time, you can now continue outside. See you next week. Zoomers, peace.